Welcome back to your free training course for Windows 7. So far, we have looked at a lot of different ways to customize your Windows 7 install to streamline the deployment of Windows 7. Microsoft has also created a number of tools to assist you with deployment and customization of your Windows 7 installs. Some of these are free, and some of these are available for purchase. One of the free tools is Microsoft Deployment Toolkit, or MDT 2010. There is a lot to MDT 2010, and I could create a complete training series just on this tool. In this video, I will just cover the basics, since that is all you need for the Windows 7 exam. MDT is a solution accelerator. Using it, there are two main methods for deploying Windows. The first is light touch installation. This method requires only a small degree of user interaction. When you use this method, you are given a series of menus to select what you want to install. If you want a completely automated install, you can use the zero touch installation method. This method, however, does require Microsoft's System Configuration Manager, which is a commercial product. Let's have a look at how to use the Microsoft Solution Accelerator on a Windows 7 computer. On my Windows 7, it is quite an easy task to install the Microsoft Deployment Toolkit. I have already downloaded the executable from the Microsoft website and placed it on the desktop. If I double-click it, all I need to do is run the setup and accept all the defaults. The install itself does not take too long to complete. Once completed, all I need to do is run Deployment Workbench from the Start menu. Once I launch Deployment Workbench, you can see at the top there is an Information Center. The Information Center includes information such as Getting Started, Documentation, and News. In the Components section, you can add additional components to MDT 2010. For example, MDT can use Windows Automated Installation Kit and Application Compatibility Toolkit. You can also add support for the User State Migration Tool. Before I get started, I need to create a new deployment share. Using this share, other computers on the network can connect up to this share and access files from my deployment solution. This share will be created on my local Windows 7 computer. However, in the real world, you would most likely install MDT 2010 and thus create the share on a Windows Server 2008. In the wizard, I need to set the standard things that I would normally set for a share. First, the path of the share. Next, the share name. And finally, the descriptive name. In this case, I have accepted all the defaults, but feel free to change them to anything that you like. If you leave the next option, Ask if an image should be captured, ticked. When deploying a new image, you will receive a prompt asking you if you want to capture the image. The next option gives the user the option to set an administrator password. If you do not select this option, the password will be blank. You can also set the password using a different method, for example, using an answer file. The last option allows you to ask the user for a product key. In a large enterprise environment, you may want to use a different method to deploy product keys. If you have a separate product key for each install of Windows 7, and a tech is deploying each operating system, you may need to enable this option. That's it for the wizard. Once I press Finish, the share will be created. If I now select the share, you can see a number of different folders which contain options for my deployment solution. For example, if I want to add an application to the deployment solution, I would select Applications and then select the option New Application. The first option in the wizard relates to whether this will be a thick or thin image. If you select the first option, the application along with its source files will be copied to the deployment share. This essentially creates a thick image. The second option will store the source files on another location on the network. When this application is needed to be installed, the source files will read from this location. The last option, Application Bundle, only installs the dependencies for the application. In this particular case, I will accept the default and copy the source files to the deployment share. On the next screen, I can set the details of the application, for example, the publisher, the application name, version, and language. On the next screen, I need to browse to where my source media is located, in this particular case, my DVD. Once this is done, I can enter in the directory name to which the files will be copied on the local computer. This directory will be created under the application's directory. On the next screen, I need to enter in the command that will be used to install MS Office 2010. That's it for the options in the wizard. Once I next my way through to the end, the source files will be copied from my DVD to the local computer. Once the application files have been copied from the DVD, the next thing I need to do is to add an operating system to my deployment share. To do this, right-click Operating Systems and select Import Operating System. You have a number of different options of where the source files will be copied from. The first option copies the source files from a DVD. If you have created a custom install and captured it to a WIM file, you can use the second option to use this file. The last option allows you to use Windows Deployment Services. Windows Deployment Services is a free role in Windows Server 2008 that allows you to deploy Windows on the network. Using Windows Deployment Services, you can boot a client from the network and install Windows 7 without the need for installation media such as a DVD. Once again, I will copy the source files from the DVD. Once I have selected the location of the source files from my DVD, I need to enter in a folder to store the source files on my local computer. The source files will now be copied to the local computer. On the final screen of the wizard, you will notice that two operating systems were imported. The first is Windows 7 Ultimate 32-bit. The second is Windows 7 Ultimate 64-bit. One of the frustrating things when performing a lot of installs of Windows 7 is having to install additional drivers after the installation is completed. If I go to out-of-the-box drivers, right-click it, and select Import Drivers, I can add additional drivers to my deployment share. The wizard is quite a simple one. Simply browse to the location of your driver and next your way through the wizard, and the driver will be added to your deployment share. If you have any software that is in CAB or MSU files, you can add these files to the packages here. Simply right-click Packages and select Import OS Packages. In this particular case, I have found a copy of Internet Explorer, which is in CAB format. Of course, Internet Explorer does come with the operating system, but by adding this package, I can upgrade Internet Explorer when I install the operating system. Again, it is a simple matter to finish the wizard, and the CAB file will be added. Before you install your operating system, you need to create a sequence of tasks. Once I right-click on Task Sequences and select New Task Sequence, I will be able to create a new sequence of tasks that I can use to install Windows 7. Later on, I will select this sequence and use it to install Windows 7. First, I need to enter in a sequence ID and a sequence name. On the next screen, you can select the template that will be used to configure your sequence. You will notice that there are a number of templates to choose from, but in this case, I will select Standard Client Task Sequence. Once selected, I now need to select which operating system I'm going to install. I only added one DVD to the deployment share, but it had two different editions of Windows 7. In this case, I will select the 64-bit edition. On the next screen, I can enter in a product key. In this case, I won't worry about it, and I will skip past to the next screen. On the OS Settings screen, I can configure the name, organization, and home page that will be used with this installation. On the next screen, I can configure the default administrator password. Once done, I only need to next my way to the finish. Once I press Finish, the task sequence will be created. Now that my deployment share is set up, I will switch to a computer running XP. To install Windows 7 on this computer, first I need to open the deployment share. Once open, you can see all the folders containing all the data that was configured in Microsoft Deployment Toolkit. If I open the directory scripts, I can run the script light touch. This will launch a wizard which I can use to install Windows 7. The script needs to access the network share, so the first thing I need to enter in is a username and a password that has permission to the share. On the next screen, you can see a list of all the sequences that I have created. So far, there is only the one. Once I select it, I get the option to either install a fresh, clean install of Windows 7 or perform an upgrade. In this case, I will select a clean install. Next, you can enter in a computer name for the new computer. On the next screen, you can add the newly installed computer to a domain or leave it in a work group. Since this is a clean install and everything will be erased, you have the choice to save user data and settings. This will save the profile and user documents. In some cases, you may want to save more than just the user profile and documents. On the next screen, you can perform a complete backup. From here on in, you can have a lot of the same options you have when performing a clean install using the DVD. For example, the language you want to install, time, currency, and keyboard layout. Next, you can see the time zone. On the next screen, you get to decide which application you want to install. In this case, I have only added MS Office to the deployment share. Once I select this, I will get the option to enable BitLocker. BitLocker enables you to encrypt the contents of the hard disk. On the next screen, I can select the option Begin to start installing Windows 7. Once I select this, the Windows 7 install will begin. You can see that there is a lot of customization that can be performed to the Windows 7 install, and a lot of tools can be used to perform this customization. Using the WIM format contains the files used by Windows, but it can't be used to boot into a live Windows environment. In the next video, I will look at the virtual hard disk format. Windows 7 not only supports the virtual hard disk format, but using the right edition, you can boot Windows using a virtual hard disk.